delicious. Thank you.
Hold on there, kiddo.
Cheese.
There you go. Thanks. What about, why don't you drop me up a little bit higher? Good morning, good morning, good morning. Time to rise and shine.
Dad.
I love it.
No.
Dad.
And they were here first.
Dad.
So you want to go catch a movie at like 7:30 or something?
Dad!
One more. Okay, one more. Wait, wait, wait. Come on, just one more. One more.
Dad!
I'm so proud of you. Now you just gotta get the job.
Dad!
You look beautiful.
And Dad?
And stand just a little closer together and move just a little bit to the left. My left. A little more.
Dad!
Now, some of you already let me know how uncomfortable you were in last week's meeting. So tonight, we're going to try to respect each other's boundaries.
What?
Tonight, we've also got a guest with us, David. And would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Hey, guys. I'm David.
David.
How many kids do you have, David?
None. At least not at the moment.
My wife is pregnant, and she should be delivering any day now.
That's great.
Super.
Oh, great. Awesome.
Who would like to go first? Anyone.
I'll go.
Perfect.
Ty?
Yes.
My daughter and I went to the mall, and she said she wanted to take the stairs to the second level. And I said, I don't trust stairs, because they're always up to something.
Todd, I'm sorry that happened. I encourage you to try to resist the urge to make jokes like that.
My turn? Can I go? Okay. Yesterday, actually, my daughter got home and she asked me how my day was. And I said, well, a guy tried to sell me a coffin, but that's the last thing I need.
Oh, shit. That joke was dead out of my mouth.
Because it's the last thing I need.
David, how about you?
Oh, I didn't.
This is a safe zone. Just jump on in.
Yeah, I guess I'm just scared of being a dad. I'm afraid I'm gonna start telling bad jokes just like my dad.
Well, it might be in our nature. We can fight against it. Hey, speaking of nature, I tried to catch some fog yesterday. I missed. M-I-S-T.
You're a monster.
This is where the boundary is. This is where you are.
Hello? Really? Okay, yeah, no. Yeah, I'll be right there.
That was Julie. Her water just broke. I guess the baby finally ran out of womb.
Oh, your dad.
Don't you think you should be going? Oh, yeah.
This week, Noah had a birthday, so we wish her happy birthday.
Yay.
Of course, happy Father's Day to everybody. You know I can't do it. Since I've been traditional in this church, I do bad Father's Day. It's just who I am. I'm trying to start a support group, but I can't. That's my quitters. So our summer today is going to be the legacy of a godly father. So God has took me and it's on a journey again to look at fathers in a different way. So hopefully you'll see something today that'll change how you look at what our responsibility is as men and as dads. And even if you're not a dad, it's applied to women too, as the principles of that. So we're going to go into a worship. Now let's pray first. And then we'll go into a worship. Lord, we just thank you for your love and mercy, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you are our great Father, Lord, that you died on that cross, Lord, that we would have everlasting life, Lord, but most of all, we could have communion with you, Lord, that we communicate and talk to you, Lord, in any time, any place, anywhere, Lord, and I thank you for that. Lord, I just ask for this service, Lord, to let it come out in a way, Lord, that's pleasing to you, Lord, that it betters us as people, Lord, that we know who you are, Lord. Understand, first we understand that you are a good Father, Lord, and what you did for us, Lord, and that way we can work from the overflow through us to others, Lord. So we say we love you with all our hearts, mind, body, and soul, and it's in Jesus' mighty name.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Your shame's done all that's stealing. And you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
like I said, our son's gonna be a legacy of a godly father. But I was sitting there, and that song that I played, "It Reaches to the Highest Mountain, It Flows to the Lowest Valleys," that's the first song I ever learned how to sing as a little child. It's the first time the Spirit of God had ever fell on me. So anytime I have something bad happen to me and I get along, I start singing that song. That's my song, that's my go-to song. Everybody got a go-to song. That's my go-to song. I feel like the presence of God is around me because it takes me back. If you've never been in the presence of God, you don't know what I'm talking about. But if you've ever been truly in the presence of God, whatever, you'll try to imitate anything you can to get back to that presence. And sometimes the church has decorated to make it look like the presence of God by putting events up. That's not what I mean. I'm just saying whatever it takes to get you back in front of Him, that's what it is. And this week was a bad week for me. As soon as I left church here, a lot of churches tell you when you find Jesus, the whole world changes and everything comes perfect and roses. It's not what happens because the devil comes immediately to seek and destroy us. And all y'all know I love my big red truck out there and I keep it spotless and clean. As soon as I left this church and I went to Publix, this person flies out and hits me in the rear end of my car. And the sad thing is it might be a no fault because it was in a parking lot and not on the road. And it's $1,700 to fix that dent. She said, well, we won't fix it because you can't hardly see it, but I can see it. So it bothered me on that. And then to top that off, we're going through litigation with my house and my compressor goes out on my air conditioner. So it's been one of them weeks that I had to go back and remind myself, and I sung that song a lot to calm me down. So that was just a little tip. So if you're going through something, know this, God is bringing some revelation word out. And if you're receiving that word, we're making the devil angry. And so he is subject to come looking for you because if he ain't looking for you, you ain't doing nothing to make him mad. You might be helping him and not hurting him. So I just, that was not on my subject, and that's free. I won't charge y'all for that. That's a little extra there, a little tidbit on there. But when I grew up, back in the, when you turn on a TV show, and the most representative I'm showing you my age now. When you went to a show, it was called a show called Father Knows Best. Yes. And this thing, whatever happened in that household, the father would take care of it. No matter what the situation was. And if he wasn't there when the situation happened, the wife would say, when your dad gets here, everything will be okay. And that's what the mentality of what the family is supposed to be like. God created Adam first for a reason. Because the man is the foundation of the home. Don't mean he's greater or better or anything, but he is the foundation. So everything God sowed into man, he's supposed to sow into his wife, which they both sow into their children, and it passes on that away. But we get away from that now. When you turn on TV, remember Leave It to Beaver? Yeah. Gee, why do you think Dad's going to yell at us? Because the dad also showed discipline. But you never seen him beat the child or abuse the child, but you knew Wally was scared, Daddy's going to get home. Because how many of us remember saying, when your dad gets home? That's the worst words you could ever hear as a child. And then the Waltons. Of course, you had the Waltons too. That was what TV shows I grew up representing the family. Now you turn on TV, you had like Married with Children, where the father is a dense, everything's got bad luck, nothing goes good. He's always put down, he's always broken, everything. And then Roseanne, where the woman's leading the house and not the man. So it's out of order. So everything when you turn on, or you can't, when you turn on a TV show now, the family's not always a man and a woman and kids. It can be a man and a man and kids, or it can be a woman and woman and kids. So that we're so confused, there's so many different transgender, LQ, I can't even pronounce all of them. Even with all this, you go in it, so the child is confused from the time because we're not set up the way God set us up for the man to be the head of the house. We depend on, now the woman has to work just as hard as the man does because we've got so out of control with her spending, it takes two to bring the income in to be able to do that. See, does that make sense? So we got to learn, as a man thinketh in his heart, so we have to, well, I'm trying to get you to look back to some of the things that work and some of the things that don't work. The family is under attack. Satan knows if he can tear the family apart, he can conquer us. Because how many knows? Unhappy wife, unhappy home. So we have to learn that my first responsibility is not to be a preacher. My first responsibility is to be a good husband. And if I do that job well enough, God will promote me from the overflow to others to witness and minister to other people. But a lot of times what happens, a lot of ministers get so caught up in ministering to the people they neglect the family. And Satan will not try to stop them because they're going against God's nature to begin with. Because God goes all the way back to the root of things. He goes back to the basis, to the house on the sandy ground won't stand. He's on a strong foundation. Jesus is the cornerstone of our foundation. He always talks about foundation. So we got to make sure our foundation is good. If you remember back in the 90s, Bill Cosby was considered America's father, great dad. He was a great, everybody voted. He even went on, he wrote a book on about fatherhood that they use a lot in child psychology about how, because he was a doctor, he was a child psychologist, what he went to school for. And everybody was rating on him. But now, where's he at? Well, he just got out of jail, I think, because of his health. But he was in jail for over 50 women accused him of sexual assault. See what I'm saying? So now, when I look at my hero, that was the ultimate dad, now was also sexual assault. So I'm saying, well, he did it. Is it okay? So we throw in confusion with the world now, society. We're living in a day and time now. We don't know right from wrong anymore. Because our heroes that we thought were heroes are the ones that done just as much messed up things we did because we were looking at them instead of what we're supposed to be doing. We took our eyes off the prize. We have to understand that man will let you down. Man is guaranteed. He don't want to. Some do. He don't really want to, but they're going to let you down because they're human. We're going to make mistakes. We're going to do stupid things, make that bad decision. So if I rely on you all the time, then I'm always going to be depressed. Amen, honey. I got that sermon this week too. they took a survey. This is. I'm going to say New Jersey. The prison in New Jersey. I don't know where it was at. I'm just kidding. There's a prison on Mother's Day. The prisoners requested over 1,000 cards so they could send out to their mothers. The same prison on the fathers only asked for 4. They say that 70% of people incarcerated come from a homeless, fatherless household. So the father is an important factor in our family and in our society. And what we've done since social media has come out, we have destroyed the father image. Yeah. He's a joke. He's stupid. He makes mistakes. There's always a woman in the background making sure she can save him from killing himself or doing something. We look like another child. Instead of having a husband, it looks like she's got another child. And that's what they have portrayed to her, and that's not what God intended it to be. Right. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, you learn 3 things God commanded the fathers to do. And that's what we're going to do. What does God say a father's supposed to be? And he gave us really 3 basic things to be a father like he intended us to be is what we're supposed to do. Love God with all your heart, soul, and mind. Which mind means that's personal. It's not somebody. You got to take care of yourself. I told you, if you ever hear me pray, I always say, with your heart, mind, body, and soul. And I just did that. But God instilled that in my spirit when I might not even know what it really means in there because I always thank him. And I'm going to get ahead of myself. I should have right there. See, learn the truth inwardly. First thing a man has to do to be a good father and a good leader, he has to get it for himself. He has to apply it inside of him. He has to truly believe that he is God, that he's the creator of the heaven and the earth, that all things are possible in him. Yeah. I can't worry about what you tell me God is. I need to find out myself who God really is. I can take an orange and be the greatest illustrator in the world and try to explain to you what that orange tastes like. I can tell you it's got that citrus smell to it. It's got like a little sting to it when you bite into it. And you're going like, really? That sounds like it's really good. But you really don't know what that orange tastes like until you eat it yourself. And then once you eat it to the left, nobody's got to tell you what it tastes like no more. A lot of us are letting everybody tell us what things are and what it tastes like instead of experiencing it ourselves. And what happens a lot of times in churches, people come to church, they hear a good word. The pastor has been with God, he's studied, he gives a word, he goes up, and they take it, and now they've got a choice. Do I apply it inward to me, or do I put it on the shelf for later on? Mm-hmm. A lot of us put it on the shelf, and I'm not really hungry right now. I'm going to go get it later when I'm with you. And we end up having a lot of leftovers that go bad in the refrigerator because we didn't go back and eat it until it was too late and it spoiled. It was out of date. So that's what a lot of times we do that spiritually, physically and spiritually we do that. The next thing is we need to lead our children diligently. And I'm going to give you the verses to back this up in a minute. So now my second job is that I've got to take and correct and lead my child in a way of God, not way of man. God said raise them up in the ways of him, not you. A lot of times we try to raise up our children to be just like us. He said raise them up in the God ways and they'll never depart. If they do depart, they'll always come home because you know why? They have a strong foundation. We have to understand, just like I always run back to that song because it triggers me that that's where I found God the first time. And guess what? I go run back to him. I'm going to see if I can find him again. It don't matter that I go sing that song, but God knows that I'm looking for him. I'm searching for him because he knows I identify with that. So therefore, what I identify the first time I pray, because the Bible says return to what? Your first love. When I was a kid, man, I loved God with all my heart, mind, but I wanted to be a preacher. I mean, I told you the first day they had a school, they had to come and get me because I got up in the cafeteria on the table and told them they're all going to hell if they don't repent. Mr. Starnes, you got to come get your son. I had a towel my uncle gave me. It was too big for me hung down here with a plaid jacket on and one of them little snail shirts on there. And none of the colors matched. Thank God it was in the 60s. And Kmart tennis shoes on. So I'm saying that I had a desire that. So I had to take, and I got away from it. And my dad and them ran from the church because they got hurt in the church. And they got hurt, and basically they got hurt over tithing, over what the different philosophies on tithing and stuff. And people are mean when it comes to money. And so my parents ran from it. And I grew up Church of God. And Church of God, it was nothing for the spirit to fall when you feel the presence of God. But they were the meanest people out of church ever seen in their life. They knew they knew God and knew the Spirit, but they didn't know that word love. They had that love that was part-time love. They didn't have that agape love that was 24/7 every day, whether you do me right or do me wrong kind of love. They was like, you do it, they'd be in there to want to lay hands on, pray for you, everything, they go out the door and they talk about you the whole time. It was like, and there was more divorces in the church than there was out of the church. Because in the church, it was so strict on law that women couldn't wear pants. They had to have long hair and all this, and no makeup, no jewelry. And then all the men ran around with the women that didn't go to church that had short hair and wore makeup. So it was ridiculous. It was like, instead of just teaching love, they taught law. And that's what they messed up. And I always want to, we have a good, good Father who loves us. And we have to understand, until we understand that love in with myself, I'll never be able to pass it out. I have to, only way I can love you is from overflow. I've always, he don't have no love. That's the reason he's mean. He's never been loved. That's the reason he's created this crime. Because they have not experienced that true love of Christ. Deuteronomy chapter 6, 1 through 7, this is where I'm going to back up what I was saying. Now these are the commandments and the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God commanded to teach you, that you might do them in the land whether you go, where ye go to possess it. That thou mightest fear the Lord thy God, and keep thy statute and thy commandments with thee. I command thee, thou and thy son, and thy son's son. In other words, all the generations. I want you, then your son's generation, then his son's generation, and his generation. See, we can't just stop with me. Because if he takes me from glory to glory to glory, if I'm satisfied here, I told you what's the worst customer would say last week was commitment. Mm-hmm. contentment. I was close saying it. I'll put more word down in the dictionary. And contentment. See, y'all gotta love me. We talking about love, you gotta love me even though I messed up. Contentment. So when we get content, then we get stagnated. And when water stands still, what does it do? It draws mosquitoes and it gets bitter and it gets poisoned. All the days of my life, and King James is kicking me this morning, thy days may be prolonged. In other words, if you do this, you got a reward. It prolongs your life. guess what? So if I want a long life, I got to make sure I diligently seek God, pass it on, and if I do that, he's always going to work through my life, and I'm going to have a long, blessed life. Not a long, miserable life. Not going to say I ain't going to have troubles and tribulations. I'm not going to ever get through this verse. I'm going to have a long life, but it'll be a good life. I don't want a long life to be misery. I heard somebody say, who was it put on Facebook? Oh, Marianne. She's making sure she gets closer to God because she's it's so hot. She knows she don't want to spend eternity in hell. Sorry, man. I just thought that was wrong. I'm calling you out on that. Hear therefore, all Israel, and observe to do it, that it may be well with thee, and that ye may increase mightily as the Lord God of our fathers hath promised thee, in the land that floweth with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou hast loved the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto the children, and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest by the way, and when thou least down, liest down, and when thou raisest up. So here we go back in. He commanded us. He says, I'm not telling you it's a choice of yours. He says, I command you, this is one of your commandments, that you love me with all your heart, and all your mind, and all your spirit. So, in other words, that's commandment. Remember in the New Testament, Jesus says, I have fulfilled all the law. Yes. Now, I'm going to give you two. Love me with all your heart, mind, body, and soul. And the second, like him, which means with the same intensity, love your neighbor. Love you even more, your enemy. So if we're commanded, that's one of our commandments of God to do. So we have to understand, that's not a choice we have, it's a commandment we have. So therefore, I believe how you get into heaven is not whether you smoke or drink or cuss, which I think there's God to clean you up. That's his job, not mine. I believe is, did you love? How much did you love? Did you really love, or did you just try to pretend you loved? So there's a lot of pretend people out there. They'll love you to see what they can get out of you. There was another one I seen on Facebook. What was the other one? Marianne didn't do this one, I don't think. But givers need to learn limits because takers have none. And I thought that was pretty neat. And my dad told me, as a good father told me, he said, son, if you ever want to be successful in life, learn this real quick. There's always givers and there's always takers. And the faster you can identify the two, the more prosperous you'll be in life. Because givers always give and takers always take. So you need to learn how to identify. So that way, he didn't say ignore them, but you can identify them. Because sometimes takers can help you out. Sometimes overflow, I can fill up so much, I need a taker. I need to give so I can have room for new and fresh. Every once in a while, we're going through our freezer now. We're starting to cook a lot of the older stuff been in a while, so we can bring new stuff in, so it's fresher. Same thing with our spiritual life. We got to rotate that out so we always have a fresh meat. Fresh word, fresh spirit, fresh flow with God, and I'm well myself. It is known to be in the cornerstone of Judaism. And Judaism, I'm not going to write it. An Orthodox Jew, this is what they do. They have to take and read this, verse 4 and 5. Appear with all your might. For hear, O Lord, thy God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and all the might. As an Orthodox Jew, in their custom, they quote that at least, I think it's, they have to do it twice a day. They physically do that twice a day to fulfill that commandment. They feel like God hears them. And of course, man, you know, that's, Jesus came and took the place. You don't have to do that. But that's what Orthodox Jews believe. And that's, they believe it so strongly, they practice it physically. Jesus quoted, this is the great command of all. So I was telling you earlier, I got ahead of myself. That's what Jesus stood up in the temple and said, okay, I'm going to give you the new law. And it all was about love. He was trying to tell you, forget about the law, because law will bring condemnation and run people away. But love will attract people. Love is attracting. Law is a judgment. The first thing God has to do with, okay, bring it, Joel. First thing is God has to be your God before he can ever show your kids he's your God. In other words, he has to be your personal king, your personal friend. He's got to be your personal leader in everything you do. It can't be a part-time thing. It's got to be every single time you do. I told you as a joke, when I played softball, I would go up in the batter's box, okay, God, which way are we going, left, right, or up the middle? And everybody goes, well, God don't care. No, he don't care. But he does care. I don't want to involve him in it. But even in my softball game and even in my thing, he's my full-time God. So we have to understand that I don't turn him off in the good and the bad or when it's convenient. If you're ever around me, and y'all guys have worked with me for a long, you'll always see me bring some kind of scripture, some kind of thing in every conversation I've got, because it's who I am. Yes. I can't overflow with something that ain't in me. I'm only going to overflow with who I am. I've had people say, well, you can't do that work, then you're going to have to fire me. Because that's who I am. I mean, I can't change, and I don't want to change. The biggest thing is I don't want to change. The heart means subconscious. You have to have love in every thought. In other words, he said, love him with your mind. All right, with your heart. Love him with your heart. But in heart, I told you that's subconscious. I have to be so saturated in my mind and in my soul, I love God. And he loves me. And he asked me to love you. I can't just practice it by saying it. I got to show it, commit it to him. How many times you watch it? You ain't got to tell me you love me if I mean. Just show me. You don't go tell me you're going. You got to tell me everything you do. Just show me. I have to see the love in you. And that's what God says. It's okay. We tell him, and we should tell him, and we should communicate to him. But a lot of times we don't show him. We say, love him. I'm a Christian. I'm born again Christian. Love God with all my heart. And God's going like, when's the last time you talked to me? Been about a week, ain't it? So if you really, my wife, I can go a week without talking to my wife. Because you know why? I love my wife, and I want to talk to my wife. So if I love something, I want to talk to it. So if you're not talking, I'm not trying to step on your toes. I'm just, truth is truth. So if you don't feel love, maybe you're not talking to him. So I'm not saying this to condemn you. I'm saying this to say maybe I'm giving you security to get closer. I'm giving you a roadmap to do that. I'm not one of these preachers going to beat you over the brow. I'm just going to give you the truth, and I'll give you an answer for it. I'll tell you a problem, but I'll give you a solution. That's why I told my guys, I got promoted, I told them, I said, look, any problem you got, feel free to come tell me, but bring a solution with it. Bring it, because you're the one dealing with it, and you're having a problem with it, so you probably got an idea of what's going to fix it. I can't guarantee that's what we'll use, but it'll go into the factors to make sure it works. So we have to understand that. Soul means emotionally. I mean, I got to be emotionally. See, some people are going, love you. Love you. I mean, we have to have it. Every time you get ready, they go, love you. Well, you ain't gonna give me a kiss by? Okay. You know what I'm saying? We get into that contentment, and we get satisfied. And it's, instead, when we first started dating, it was going like, you couldn't wait to get that kiss. You wanted to date, hurry up then, so you get a goodbye kiss. So we don't have that kind of love anymore because we've got content. And how do you get over it? You've got to get emotionally. You've got to say, you know what? I love this person. And it's not, I'm not going to let my emotion stop me from that. Mm. We have, you know, when I got my truck got hit, the old Joel would have come out with guns. And I did jump out of the truck quick. But all I did was I just looked up. I'm your child. I need your help now. And I didn't lose my temper. And my wife said, oh, she's praying. And then she says, you know, you did it. I'm so proud of you. And I'm like, be quiet. Strength, that means, okay, the word strength, if you read it in some translation, it says the word strength. And this Hebrew word strength is the only time it was used as a noun. We use it as a verb. The word, the Hebrew word, the English Hebrew word for that strength is very. Translates the word very. In other words, he said, everything you got. I mean, you can't half speed it. If you ever see me walk across the floor, I'm wide open. I mean, I'm going A to B. I don't tarry in between there. And that's the emotion I had to spiritually. I had to go, that word strength means very. So when you hear me pray, I love you with all my heart, mind, body, and strength. God, I love you emotionally. I love you physically. I'm full of you. And I want to tell you, I'm doing it with every single ounce of strength I've got. Every bit inside. I'm not coming at you doing it. I love you, Lord. Amen. I open up my Bible once a year. once a week. I'm hungry. I can't wait to get up in the morning so I can walk in his will. Now that sounds cocky. But I get up in the morning and say, I'm walking in God's will. He's got a plan for me. Because he ain't no liar. He says he's done went out in front of me and prepared a path for me. Right. So if he's done that, then I can't wait to go see what he's got for me. Mm-hmm. Now sometimes I don't like the taste of it, like a Brussels sprout. it's kind of bland, but I ain't going to go get me a bowl of Brussels sprouts when I'm hungry. but it's good for you. So sometimes what we just because it ain't what we thought it is, don't mean it wasn't God leading us to do that. Sometimes we lead ourselves into trouble, and he's saying, I'm getting you out of it. You got to keep walking. Don't tarry like David did on the rooftop. What David did on top of the rooftop wasn't a sin until he tarried. Right. That's when we start giving it power, when we tarry in something. If we're going to tarry, let's tarry in the goodness of his love and his mercy and his kindness. Because that's what he tells you. He says, when you've done all you can do, what does God say? Stand. And when you stood all you could stand, what he said to do? Stand some more. That was the most hypocritical verse God had really shown me for. And he took me back to a fight one time. I told you, speaks in your own language. And I was in a boxing ring. And I was really good. I mean, I'm not being arrogant. I was pretty good. And so I was in there, and I started showing off. So this one guy, he was a big, tall guy. And I got up there, and I hit him. Harder than I think I've ever hit a man before. And he smiled. I won that fight on points because I ran like a dog. I got my lead early and I ran like a dog. He told everybody what a great fighter I was. The whole time I was full of fear. I was scared to death because I knew I had hit him with everything I had and I had no more in me and it didn't even budge him. And God said, that's what you do to the devil when you stand. You remind me that I crushed him and I defeated him on Calvary. So when you think you're going through that, you stand. When I tell you to stand, you stand. There's a reason. You're putting fear in the enemy's eye. And I, just like that, he took me to that story. And I just, it always comes back to my remembrance on that. Deuteronomy 6:5. The message Bible says it like this. Love God with all you. Love God, your God, with your whole heart. Love him with all that's in you. Love him with all you got. And that was all you got is the word strength. In other words, you got to love him with every single bit of strength you have. You're on your deathbed, can't take your last breath is loving God out of this world. Because guess what? Because the absence of the body here is the presence of him there. So we don't have an excuse to be sad. 2 Timothy 1:5. When I recall to remembrance the unfinished faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also. This is Paul talking to Timothy. He says, I seen the strength and the faith in your grandma. I seen it in your mama. So first generation grandma, next generation mother, and now that same strength I see in you. That's what I say from the, remember he said, I tell you his commandments, love God with all your heart, mind, body, soul, in your grandfather, your dad, and your son, and the son's sons. In other words, it's got to be a flowing love. It can't be a contentment. I love so much, my love overflows to my wife. Our love overflows to our children. Our love for them overflows to our grandchildren and to their grandchildren. They say the way that the best, inheritance you can live in biblical days that you didn't leave it to your son, but you left it to your grandson's son. That's what kind of blessing God wants to have. That he says, I don't want you to give it to one. I want it to keep moving. I'm a flowing God. I'm a continuous God. I'm not a one-day God. I'm the same today, tomorrow, and in the future. You can't outrun my love. You can't outrun me. You can't outrun my power. The devil is, everybody says the enemy of God is the devil. No. God has no enemy. Because if he had an enemy, he had somebody who was level as him. And there's nobody on his level. So God has no enemy. The biggest enemy to God is our free will. Sometimes what we do, not even the devil. We blame the devil, but really we have authority over the devil. He resides in us. Abraham Lincoln said, for a man to train up a child in a way that he should go, he must walk that way himself. Mm. Abraham Lincoln said, you know what? Before I can expect it out of my child, I got to make sure I do it. Yes. How many times do you hear the story? Don't do what I do, do what I tell you to do. Yeah. And the kids go like, got you. Whatever it takes to get out of this situation, I'm going to do it because I don't have no trust in you. We see, I said something yesterday and I told my wife, I said, that was my dad. I heard my dad. I mean, I could hear this distinct voice coming out of my mouth. And I'm going like, I am getting old. No, I'm just kidding. What are you laughing for? But I heard that soon because you know what? That was my dad. That's what I remember. My dad was, if you get my parents and you put a gun to their head and say, tell me a lie, you have to pull the trigger. My dad, he's a liar's first cousin to a thief. Hey, we got more whippings for lying than we did for actually what we did. We got a lot of lying whippings. Because we thought we were smarter than that. But I remember my dad always being fair, disciplined. Mm-hmm. He always provided. And now I got older and I go back and look at some of his check statements and his bank accounts, and he made $20 a day. It was ridiculous what he got paid, and he had five boys, buried two. And I go back going like, wow, how did he do that? Because we always had clothes, we always had food, we always had a roof over our head. We never was hungry, never went without anything. Might not have been what we wanted, but we always had stuff. And so I wanted to admire my dad. And if I ever grow up, I wanted to be like my dad. Now, I didn't want to do it the way he did it because my dad was he did it in a restrictive law way, which that worked for him. And it made me who I am today. So I don't hate him for it. I believe in loving people. I believe in loving it out of them. Now, sometimes love might be with a belt. It might be some discipline in there, but it's done in love, not out of anger. A lot of times we do things out of anger. The second thing, learn to trust inwardly. So we have to learn how to, Deuteronomy verse 6 says, as these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. In other words, I got to have it here first. Yes. I got to have the true revelation inside of me. I got to believe it inside out, upside down, left to right, up to down, and I have to believe it in the good and in the bad. Especially in the bad, I got to really believe that before I can pass it on to you. Because people look for your weakness. And here's what I think. When I was a kid, I go like, they just watch and see if I mess up. I don't think that's true. I think that's what the devil wants you to think. I think they're watching you to see if you can make it through. They want somebody that really does what they say they believe and do it. And when you mess up, it hurts them because they say, well, now where do I go look for it? See what I'm saying? So I look at it. So when people are watching, because people watch you, I mean, you don't believe it goes, go up in a hospital and look out the window, and everybody watches the people walk through the parking lot, and they ain't got a clue nobody's watching them. Right. They ain't got a clue. So somebody's always watching you. And the way you present yourself is whether you're doing it of God or is it of yourself. And only way you can present yourself to God is you got to eat it, be saturated with it, and that's who you are. Just like I said, if you ever talk to me, I'm always bringing up something out of Scripture. Always something out of Scripture, because that's who I am. It's in me, so it's going to come out of me. This shows our relationship is true, not opinions. In other words, when you practice it in yourself, it proves that it is really who you are. It's the truth. It's not an opinion. It's not a wishy-washy. What did God say? He can't. He said, I'd rather you be lost than wishy-washy. Yeah. That's the only thing that makes God throw up, because he said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. He cannot say in a lukewarm one. How many of you had somebody, and a name's going to probably pop your head when I say this, that when you was in a situation, while they was with you, man, yeah, you're right, and then the other party walk up and with them, and they're going like, yeah, you know, they shouldn't have done it that way. And then when you both got there, they won't take a side. And that's one person you need to right out of your circle. Because all they are instigators and troublemakers. You still got to love them, but you ain't got to hang around them because they're trying to hurt you. There's a lot of people around who don't want to pick a side. You need to pick a side. Either you are or you ain't. Right. And that's from God. That's God's word, not my word. You can't give truth if you don't have it. How can I tell you truly how to fly a plane when I have no knowledge on how to fly a plane? It's not that I'm a bad person. I mean, just because I can't fly a plane, but I'm not going to go into a pilot school and try to teach them how to fly a plane and tell them, no, you're wrong. The book says this. And I ain't never been in a plane before. And a lot of times we're going out there trying to witness to people about the truth. It's not even we know it's true. See, when I first got saved, I was scared to minister to somebody because I didn't know the Bible. I knew the Bible what I heard people read, but I never knew the Bible except when I was a kid, not as an adult. When I got saved this last time, I said, God, you said any way, fair and full. And I read the Bible, and I read it once. I read it numerous times, in and out. You show me. I don't want to hear man no more. I want you to show me. But before, I was scared to quote anything because I didn't know if I was quoting it wrong. I didn't know if I could. You don't ever hear me quote a verse exactly right, because I'm not telling you, I don't have the greatest memory anymore. But I know what's in the word, and I know what it means. So I can still speak the word without telling you it's in James, Mark, Matthew. I can give you the idea, or I can go find it for you. I know where to go find it. I'm not one of the guys. My grandpa could quote the Bible. You say John 3, verse 6, and he would start one verse ahead and tell you word for word what the verse said in the King James verse. Tell you where there's a period, a comma, anything. That's how good he was. I'll never be that way. And that's not who I am. Mine is, I know what the word says. And so when I go to witness to somebody, I don't go timid. I go boldly. Because I know what the word says and what the word means. Only way you can minister to anybody is you can minister them to boldly. And only way you get boldly, you got to make sure it's in you inwardly. We have to understand that. Psalms 37. The law of God is in his heart. None of his steps shall slide. In other words, he's saying that in Proverbs, it's the wisdom ones in there. He says, if you have the word in your heart, which is your conscious, and with everything subconscious, subconscious thing is the word, then I ain't got to worry about my steps. You follow what I'm saying? I don't need to worry about steps and not have the word in my heart. See, if I'm worried about my steps, I don't know what the word says I am. What I tell you, the first thing the devil does, he tries to get you to lose your identity. So if he can forget who you are the Word, because if he dwells within you, he was the Word made flesh. So if he dwells within you, then the Word dwells within me. Yes. So therefore, the Word is in my heart, then my steps are always going to be guided right. We have to understand that. Well, as a man thinketh, so is he. Psalms 48, I desire you to do your will, my God. Your law is within my heart. In other words, it's telling you, it's got to be in your heart. It's got to be in your subconscious. It's got to be your whole being. Psalms 119, the word shall hide in my heart that I might not sin against thee. In other words, what is sin? Sin is to know to do good and do wrong. If you don't know it, it's not sin. That's the reason a lot of times children are not held accountable because they don't know the difference between the two. But once they have knowledge of that, then it becomes sin to them. So I have to make sure that I have knowledge in my heart. Have the word in my heart, therefore, that I might not sin. In other words, that now I can take a reason in myself that that's wrong. When you're a child, when you stole a cookie and when your parents wasn't there, they come in the room and you'd be all going like, no, I know I took that cookie. I mean, your conscience would eat at you. And then they didn't know it. And then you got away with it. And as you got away with it, you stopped listening to that voice anymore. So it was just part of the day. I just go steal two cookies. I steal three cookies. And that voice was still telling you it's wrong. It's wrong. It's wrong. But we subconsciously have got away with it so much, it's okay now. And when you do it enough, you're not doing nothing wrong anymore. I've been doing it for years. Now you're going to bring and get me in trouble? But it's been a lie from day one. We just hit it in the heart wrong. Colossians 3. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. Teach admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. That's the reason I told you every time I have trouble, that song identifies me. It sets the atmosphere for me. It gets my heart conditioned. That's the reason God says, come to him with praises. Because guess what? If you, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. That's my scripture after scripture. So if I think I'm whooped and lost, and can't be no good,
I can't be infected in the throne because I'm not going to pay him no attention because I don't know it myself. So I had to first understand who I am. Okay, God, you said if I'm faithful to ask, you're faithful to hear. And if you're faithful to hear, you're faithful to answer. So I come to you willing. Lord, I messed up. You know I messed up. But I'm here before you telling you I don't want to do it no more. And I'm sorry. Forgive me because I love you so much. I offended you. And I had to make it right. It has to be my desire. If I do something wrong, when you do something wrong with your mate, you can't wait to apologize to him. When you find you messed up, I was wrong. Because you want to mend that relationship. And so when you sin against God, you're actually turning your back on him. You're actually saying that he wasn't worthy enough. That's strong words, but it's the truth. I'm just speaking what it is. I mean, it's the truth. You're not literally doing it, and you're not doing it intentionally, but subconsciously, spiritualized, that's that voice saying it was wrong to steal that cookie. And if you don't identify with it, it's going to be harder and harder to get back to his presence because you built a wall against it. Elizabeth Elliot was a missionary to the Indians. The word of God, I think, of is a straight edge, which shows up on our crookedness. That you can really tell how crooked other thinking is until we line up with a straight edge of Scripture. In other words, I can't correct your crookedness. And I can't judge your crookedness until I make sure I'm judging it from straightness. A lot of times we're not even sure what straight is, and we're eyeballing it. And we're trying to, in any type of construction thing, the most important thing is a ruler and a level. Mm-hmm. But a lot of guys eyeball it.
Yeah.
And by the time it might be off just a 16th of an inch, by the time you get 22 foot down there, you're off a foot. Yeah. And they can't figure out what happened. Because I was within the bubble. I was within the bubble, but it matters. It might not show up there, but it's going to show up down here. Yes. Right now, as a child, I stole a cookie and hid it from my mom. Next year, I might try to rob a bank and get away with it. We got to condition ourselves that I got to take care of it now. It's easier to fix here. It's easier here to fix. The worst I can do is get time out. You know what I'm saying? The worst I can do. I'd rather get corrected here so I don't have to worry about it down here.
Yes.
And that's what's happened to the world today. The devil's attacked the family. You can't trick. Punish kids anymore because now you might hurt their feelings. Mm-hmm. they're going to be psychologically scarred for life because our generation, it was because my dad mistreated me that I went out and robbed banks. Now when you go to a psychiatrist, the first thing they do is what? They ask about your childhood.
Yeah.
And some of it's true, but I left home at 18 years old. I'm 60 years old. I've been away from my dad's household for a long time. So anything that happens ain't my dad's fault no more. I've had time to correct it and change. So quit worrying about what I did as a child, because that's got, it might have affected me, but I've had time in the Word to find out that's not who I am anymore. So we have to understand, quit blaming others. It's that woman you gave me. You wouldn't give her that woman. I wouldn't have ate the fruit. Yes, we would still be in the garden naked. The word of God is our manual. It tells us how to get what we need when we're hurting for things. Old Proverbs said, I correct my spelling there. Old Proverbs says, one generation plants the tree, and the next generation gets to enjoy the shade. In other words, as an old proverb saying said, if I plant a tree, I'm going to enjoy the tree, but my kids and grandkids are going to get to enjoy sitting under the shade of it. So if I had the mentality that I just want it for me, I won't plant a tree, I'll go plant a tomato. Then it just lasts for me. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. But if I'm doing it, my kids' kids and his kids can give what I earn for what we do. That's the mentality we're supposed to have as godly fathers. Lead your kids diligently. We can't just do it part-time. I mean, you know, the TV is probably the worst, biggest babysitter in the world.
Yeah.
And when you turn on the TV, you don't have the family shows on no more. You don't have to leave it to Beavers and the Waltons and none of that show. You don't have that anymore. Our favorite show is ID Channel. Everybody's killing everybody. I love watching the ID Channel. I love you, honey. In the back. It's better than soap operas. Deuteronomy 6. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children,
and shalt talk to them when thou sittest in thy house, and when thou walkest in the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. In other words, when I was a kid, 4:30, every day, you're at the table. Mm-hmm. We ate a meal at the table together. Kids are quiet, mom and dad's talk, and we spoke when you were asked a question. And you didn't eat till you said the blessing. And when you got up to the table, you sat there till the Father got up and said, it's time to go. You didn't watch TV. You didn't talk on the phone, because they didn't have cell phones. We didn't have phone in the house. You didn't do that. And so what happened, the family had oriented. Talk to them. You could talk to your children. You could talk to them. They knew what was going on in the household. They heard this discussion between the man and the woman and what the good and the bad was. That's where you learned. That was your family communication. And so when I got married, I bought a table. And I bought 8-chair table. And I lived by myself for a long time, for 10, 12 years. And so when I would eat my supper and my breakfast at that table by myself. And me and my wife, to this day, we eat our supper at that table. That's when we talk. That's when we say what happened to our day. And that thing, I went back to the old. I returned to the first love. I remember that discipline, and that's what my household is. I want to be like the old days, and it has to start with me. I would never be sitting at the table every day if I wouldn't discipline myself to do it by myself when nobody else was watching. Right. See what I'm saying? It makes sense now. It doesn't say church teach them. It says father teach them. We send them off to Bible schools and all this kind of thing. And them, that's where they're getting their doctrine, is from what they hear in church. Doctrine, I remember I said one thing, because it was a different denomination and they didn't believe in the Trinity. They believed in Jesus only. Mm-hmm. I do too, but in a different way. There's threefold. But they can get mean with it. And they asked me to leave their church because they said, you're teaching my kids false doctrine. I said, I've never taught. If you ever heard me teach, I teach about love, who you are, and in Christ. And I pray in Jesus' name just like you do. So, and I told him, it's not my job to teach your kids doctrine. My job is just to love them and say what the Word of God says. Tell them the truth of what the Word is. Not to think and tell them what to think. Tell them the truth, then they have a choice. And then I want another church. But people get so mean, they wait on the teacher and to do that, and not doing it in their household. In Hebrew, the word parent is the same root word for teacher. Did you know that? In Hebrew, the word parent also means teacher. So as parents, we are supposed to be the teacher of our children. Well, that was country, not children. We're supposed to be teachers of our children. Boy, I'm getting soul coming out of me today. We're supposed to be the teacher, not the teacher. We're sending them to school. And what are they learning in school? In the second grade. Do you want to be a boy or a girl? Uh-huh. That's mean. And so you shouldn't say that publicly, but it's the truth. We're having other people teach our kids false doctrines. When it's my job to teach our kids, this is what the Word of God says. I don't care what nobody says. I don't care if I say something different. If it don't line up with this Word of God, don't believe it. Yes. But the only way they're going to believe it, they're going to have to see it in me first. And now I'm supposed to be the teacher. The mama's supposed to be the teacher. We're supposed to be teaching our children. And guess what? Teachers are the ones going to be held accountable. Yes. They're going to be held accountable. Just like I'm going to be held accountable to a higher standard than you. For the fact I'm up here teaching the Word of God. And there's people, and the first one cast in the pit of hell, you know who it is? It's not the devil. It's the false prophets. Yes. So God said, I'm putting them in first because they're the one that took and kept my people from me. Mm-hmm. We need to revive the godly men to step out of the calling. In other words, as men and good godly fathers, we need to step into our calling. Yes. And the calling is not to be a teacher. It is to be a teacher. It's not to be a preacher, a congregational. It's to be a good husband and a good father. And I'm so full of God inside of me that very in me, that becomes a noun, becomes who I am. No, I just hope that was good, Lord. The verb in me, which that word is always used, strengthens, always used as a verb in our English language. But that one time that was used as a noun, he says, I want you to be so very, it becomes a noun. You're such a verb in love that you become a noun in love.
That's good. We have to understand that. Proverbs 4:1, listen, my son, to the father's instruction, pay attention, and gain understanding. See, the children's going to have to learn to, but it's listening to the father. They're not going to learn that if you don't teach them that. They ain't going to understand the ways of God if you don't teach them. Because out there, you're just a number. What's the first thing you do when you get of age? Go get a number. Yeah. You need a social security card. You become a number. From that day on, you're just a number. Can I get a loan for a car? What's your social security number? What's your driver's license number? You become a number into the industry, not a person. I could be a rotten single person, but have a good number.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? And then I can get anything I want. Or I can be bad luck and have everybody file bankruptcy on me, but be a good person and have a bad number. We have to understand, you become a number as soon as you become accountability. Proverbs 6:12, my son, keep thy father's commandment and do not forsake your mother's teachings. In other words, for the children to have a long life, they got to what? Honor. Honor your mother and your father, and what? Your days will be long on this earth. We have to learn to honor them. And say we have to agree with them with everything they do, but we by the word of God, the truth, we got to honor them. My dad was I'm just saying an example. My dad was a murderer, a killer, and all this stuff. I'm still required by God to love him.
Yes.
I don't have to condone what he's doing, but I got to love him. Because guess what? He's not going to ask me to do something he's not going to do. Because he loves him just as much as does us too. The difference is, nothing will separate us from the love of God except our hard hearts.
Yes.
Ephesians 6:4. Father, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in training and instruction of the Lord. That's what I said earlier. Our job is not to take, in other words, this word here means, don't bring them up in your ways. Okay, I'm a baseball player, so I want my son to play baseball and he's going to have a career in baseball. No, he says, bring him up in the ways of the Lord. In other words, teach him love. Let love be his verb. His verb verb becomes a noun verb. You see what I said? Noun verb. John 3:4. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. You want to make God happy? Walk in truth. You want to please God? Walk in truth. You want God? You show how much you love God? God says, if you'll love me, you'll keep my commandments. It will say, keep my commandments to prove you love me. He said, no, if you love me, I ain't going to tell you not to do that. Because you don't want to offend me. Right. That's the kind of love. We look at it a different way. Joshua, and it seemed evil to you to serve the Lord. Choose you this day whom I shall will serve. Whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood or the gods of the Amorites and whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua says, I'm the man of this house, and you can go serve the gods of the Amorites or the ones before the flood come, but my household are going to know the ways of God. And that's what we have to do as the leaving legacy of a godly man. We have to start with us that we do it. Look here. This is my last illustration. Eve took the first bite. Y'all agree with me that?
Yeah.
God come running right then, didn't he? No, he didn't. God come around and wants Adam ate the thing. Because you know why? He created Adam, the foundation of that land. It didn't come sin because of Adam's sin. We had to have a Savior. Eve did it because she wasn't the head of the house. She was out of order. But when he took the bite, Adam, where are you? There's a separation now. A separation from us. So we have to understand to be a godly father, it's got to start with us. And everything we judge on your household, women, you take the man's name. Because guess what? He's the one head of that household. And all things are going to be judged on his name. Because now you take his name on. Good, bad, or indifferent. We have to understand it starts with the man. And so if it starts with me, why am I worried about you? Why am I spending all my effort on you when all of it depends on me? So if I'm going to fix somebody, I'm going to fix me. And by fixing me, God's going to show other people what he did for me. And if he'll do it for me, he'll do it for you.
Yes.
That's how you win people. Charity begins at home.
We need to quit playing in everybody else's backyard and go back home and build the fence so the temple can be established again. When the wall, when the prophet told that, when they rebuilt the wall, they rebuilt it back in a remarkable time, he had everybody go out in their backyard and build their wall.
Yes.
It all hooked up to cover the wall, to rebuild the wall again. So we have to understand, quit pointing fingers. Martin Luther King said, they asked him how would he create world peace. He said, simple. It can be done overnight. He said, everybody go home and take care of your own family. And if you'll do that, world peace will come. And that's the way I'm going to leave it. Lord, we thank you for your love and mercy, Lord. Thank you for what you've done for us on that cross, Lord. But most of all, Lord, we thank you that you first loved us, Lord. And that our love becomes, is such a verb in us, Lord, it becomes a noun of who we are, Lord. Because I believe my whole heart that's what we're going to be judged by, Lord. Lord, let us be great lovers of you, Lord. But most of all, lovers of people, Lord. That we desire that no one should not be make it into heaven, Lord. That would be your desire, so that is our desire, Lord. So as we go out this week, Lord, I just pray a special blessing on each and every one. Lord, I ask you pray a special blessing of all the fathers, Lord, out there that they learn who they are, Lord, and they walk in their legacy, Lord, and in their calling, Lord. And Lord, we just say we love you with all our hearts, mind, body, and soul, and it's in Jesus' name.